Episode 63 of the Loaded Couch Podcast. On the show, we have adult-only swimming pools. We go crazy for E3. Again, fat tubes, questions from listeners,
and
beer.
Beer.
Reach in at your own risk. This is The Loaded Couch.
He was channeling his inner Bob Ross there. And
happy little beer.
That's right.
Happy little beer.
I can't wait till we talk about shows, Joe. You probably don't remember some of the shit you said.
No.
All right, let's go.
All right, we're back. Episode 63 of The Loaded Couch. I'm Scotch Hound.
I'm Pigeon Peg Leg.
And Celtic Fox.
And before we get started, let's talk about our beers. I'm drinking the Nitro American Stout from Left Hand Brewing Company. It's a stout from Longmont, Colorado. It's black, and it's 6% alcohol. And just real quick on the bottle, it says, super smooth with soft roastiness and mocha notes.
Ooh.
Enjoy at 40 to 45 degrees Fahrenheit in a stout glass. Number one. Pour hard. Number two, admire and enjoy.
Number three, you don't have a stout glass, do you?
I don't think I do, but no.
Maybe what is a stout glass? Is that's just a shaker, right?
That's what it looks like in the little picture. It doesn't look like anything fancy, so I don't know.
Oh, so maybe you do have it right.
Hey, what are you guys drinking?
I got the Celtic bought a beer for E3. It's called the Fathead Barley Wine. It's from the Brisco Brewing Company. It's a barley wine ale aged in whiskey barrels located in Nebraska, brownish red, and it's a 12.1% alcohol. We were supposed to have it at E3. We never got to it, so I traded Kelk this beer for an Omegang chocolate stout.
Ooh. All right, Kelk, what are you drinking?
It may be illegal trading beer. I don't know.
Hey, you weren't over state lines, so it's probably okay.
Yeah, okay.
It's like a black market. I'm drinking the 120-minute IPA from Dogfish Head.
And that's going to destroy your stomach.
Actually, it's soothing it a little bit. It's their IPA, again, Dogfish Head's out of Milton, Delaware. And it's a little, cloudy. It's like a cloudy orange color.
Yep.
This bad boy's 15 to 20% ABV, somewhere in that range, I guess. Yep. It depends on the batch. So
we don't know.
Yeah.
That's kind of crazy. In beer news, an adult only outdoor pool with room for more than 1,000 guests will open at the Borgata Hotel Casino early next month. The casino in Atlantic City's Marina District also plans to debut an outdoor bar in July that will offer a food and drink menu that includes more than 15 craft and domestic beers and cocktails. All right, so it's going to include more than 15 craft beers, but it'll also have domestic beers and cocktails, I'm assuming.
Yeah, so is Budweiser going to buy up things to put their beers on tap like they did for that Seattle bar?
Maybe.
Maybe.
I wouldn't see why not, especially if it gets busy.
Mm-hmm.
Speaking of getting busy, we've got a beer garden.
How much do you think those craft beers are going to cost?
In my price range, $9 bottles.
Yeah.
I'm okay with that.
Wait, no, because it's... will include more than 15 craft beers. Oh, so it's not saying that they'll be on tap.
They'll just
have them at the bar. Okay.
Who knows?
Yeah.
It'll be expensive.
The Borgata Beer Garden, which will also feature a stage for live entertainment, lawn games, and fire pits, is scheduled to open to the public on July 1st.
Lawn darts.
Yeah, I doubt that, but that could be interesting with 1,000 people
around. They'll have a lawn dart set up right next to the Bikini Twister game.
Yeah.
Look at Kelk. Such earring mines in the gutter tonight, dude.
The 3,200 square foot pool, which will only be available to hotel guests who are at least 21 years of age. That's crazy.
So maybe it's a nudie pool?
Yeah, well, I would think being associated with the hotel, the casino like this, 21 and up is the only way to go.
Yeah, especially with serving beer, probably poolside and stuff.
I think that's how it was when I was at what's the other one that's right there by the in the Marina district? Yeah.
Harrah's?
Yeah, I think that's where I went for the convention this past January, and they had an indoor pool, and they had like a bouncer type thing checking people to go in and stuff, and it seemed like it was all above or, you know, 21 people that were in there because they had like a DJ playing the one that I think it was a Saturday night or Sunday night that I got there that they had the DJ in there during the day.
And you were the one guy that did the belly flop in the pool.
Nah, I didn't visit the pool on that trip. It was January. I wasn't pool ready whatsoever. the pool will be surrounded by hundreds of cabanas, chaise lounges, and day beds, and will be open daily 7 a.m. to 7 p.m.
That's weird. If it's a 21-only pool and it's only open till 7, it's kind of PM. Goofy.
Yeah, you'd think, well, it's outdoors, so.
I think the mentality behind that, though, is they want to get you inside gambling.
Yeah. When the day's
over. Mm. Yeah, but it's open at 7. No 21-year-old that has a job wakes up at 7. They always wake up at noon.
That's true. Maybe they're looking for the older crowd at that point to come in early and then leave early. You know, so they can make it to their early bird special dinners.
Like me. <Okay.
laughs> Calc, what'd you watch in movies? Doesn't look like anything.
Yeah, it's a big negative. Oh, no movies.
Right. Moving on. Pidge, what'd you watch?
I watch The Witch and Jurassic World.
Oh, me too.
Yeah, what you
not
think
the witch,
of
but Jurassic World?
What did you watch? I'll get back to you on The Witch. I'll tell you what it's about in a second. I just want to know what you watched.
I watched Jurassic World, Jupiter Ascending, and The Martian. The Martian, yeah, with Matt Damon.
Matt Damon.
Yeah. I liked the Jurassic World. It was good. I mean, for, you know, playing into, I like how it brought back the old entry building or whatever in the park when the what's that? What was the first one called? Jurassic Park?
Jurassic Park, the first one. I like how they had all the little subtle, like, hints and throwbacks to the original one.
Right.
Yeah, yeah, that was pretty Jeep, cool.
Getting that thing started off of a little Kawasaki battery coming out of the go-kart.
Yeah.
It's almost like as you're watching it, you're like, oh, I've been here before. I know this spot. It was pretty cool. Right. I liked it.
Pidge, what'd you think?
I enjoyed it. I thought it was really well done. It was like, constantly moving, like, fast-paced.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of action, but the ending, I mean, it was sort of unpredictable, but the very last part of the movie was just super cheese.
I was waiting for, like, a dinosaur high five.
Yeah, I was waiting for that, and then when, at the very, very end, when they were, like, holding hands and walking off, I was like, oh come on. Cheese ball.
Again.
Yeah, I think I said that, like, I watched this, I think, last year. And I was saying that to you guys. I'm like, the movie was actually surprisingly very good. It's just like the way they wrapped it in the last like 20 minutes kind of made it big time cheese.
Mm.
Yeah.
Of course, I couldn't stand the one bad guy.
One bad guy. Oh, of course you hate him. You know, you hate him in everything he does.
Yeah, I do. I can't stand him as Kingpin. And, you know, why would I like him in Jurassic World?
Spoiler alert.
Yeah. So tell us about The Witch.
The Witch. I don't know if you guys remember. It came out last year. It was kind of like that independent film. Okay, it's in 1630, a mother and father lead a devout Christian life, homesteading on the edge of an impassable wilderness with five children, when their newborn son mysteriously vanishes and their crops fail. The family begins to turn on one another. The Witch is a chilling portrait of a family unraveling within their own fears and anxieties, leaving them prey for an inescapable evil. So it's a sense, at the end of the movie, it says it's based on like history and books from around that time in the 1630s.
Okay.
So if you kind of remember, back then they always thought people were witches and evil and casting spells and stuff. So it's really good. I don't understand that old English language sometimes. You know, come hither to thy thee, and thy mother keeps thy husband warm. You know, stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
But I would recommend to see it. I mean, it's not super scary. There's one or two jumps.
Okay.
But it's not a scary movie. I was hoping for a scary movie, but it's definitely an intriguing movie.
Hmm. Is it more of like a movie like about paranoia? Is that like the main driver of it?
No, it's more about, not about paranoia, but kind of like, I'm your family, why don't you trust me?
Mm. Okay.
Kind of thing. Maybe it is based on paranoia,
Yeah, I think they were just, like you said, a little bit like Salem Witch. Like, there was very much paranoia back then.
Yeah, I guess you could say it's paranoia. So, yeah, I would recommend to see it.
Okay. The Passion of the Christ is getting a sequel as Mel Gibson is moving forward on a film that tells the story of Jesus' resurrection.
Did you guys see the first one?
Yeah, I did. It was a long time. I liked it a lot. I saw it, though.
No, I didn't see it.
I don't know about you, but I cried.
I don't remember. It was like right when it first, I think, released after it was in the movies. Once it released on disc or whatever, I think I saw it. So
yeah, I gotta figure it out. But yeah, I would look forward to a second one. Sure. The first, I like the first one a lot, and I think Mel Gibson, the movies and as an actor, he's pretty good.
Mm. What about as a husband?
Braveheart. And as a racist, no.
Christopher Nolan. Sorry, go ahead.
2004.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Christopher Nolan may be crashing a plane in his next film, Dunkirk.
Fox.
Warner Brothers recently signed a $5 million check to purchase a vintage World War II aircraft, which will be outfitted with IMAX cameras to be used in some sequence in the film. And when they're done, they're going to crash it.
That seems like quite a waste to history and like with all this... Yeah, well, with all the CG now, you would think that that's something they could just send on over to ILM and let them do.
Right.
Yeah, but I don't think he does CG in his movies. I think he tries to do all practical effects.
Well, if I was a studio head in this situation, I'd say, like, we're doing this on computer.
Not even that. Why not just pick up like a really cheap tiny plane, and replica body over it or something.
Or in The Dark Knight, he had that whole 18-wheeler do that front flip.
Oh, yeah, with the that wasn't wire CG.
Yeah, and then I think in Interstellar, he said that they built the fifth dimension. You know, when he was in the fifth dimension with all the strings and stuff and touching books?
I thought you meant literally. Like, they actually had some astrophysicists to find the fifth dimension and build it.
Yeah, created the wormhole for the movie.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, he crashed himself into that black hole. Spoiler alert. But I don't know, man. It does seem smart, but I like to see it.
Yes. Dunkirk.
He does some good movies. Dick Fox. Dunkirk, Dick Fox.
Okay. TV. Celtic, what'd you watch?
I caught a couple bits and pieces, but for the most part, the first four episodes of the new Voltron series.
Ooh, me too.
On Netflix.
Nice.
It brought back a lot of childhood memories and I think they did it very good justice. It's actually very entertaining, and it explains the storylines very well, I think.
Am I mistaken? Wasn't there a female character in the older cartoon that was part of the crew?
What episode have you seen up to?
Okay, there's a hint.
Two or three.
Keep watching. Keep watching.
Okay.
Now, could you guys... Knowing that what you watch now, could you have lived without having this redone?
No, I think it really does it that much justice. I think it's really well done, and my son loves it.
Yeah,
Is it a homage to older people, or is it for the younger kids?
I think it's both. Personally,
it's both. Again, it's really well done.
Yeah, my son's enjoying the crap out of it. Like, he, you know, on his TV days and stuff, when the kids aren't gaming, he's been turning to that the last few days. So, yeah, definitely say it's good for both. Huh? Pidge, what'd you watch?
I watched some more Ballers.
Say, what didn't you watch?
I watched some more Ballers. Enjoying it. I think I'm going to finish it out.
Okay. Well, let's get the Hollywood's Viagra in it. So, of course, you're enjoying it.
Yeah, I have. Yeah, of course. Look at him; he's amazing. I watched Game of Thrones.
Okay, me too.
And Joe, you watch other things. After E3 was over on day zero, we got lit. we got so drunk. Joe, we watched Bob Ross episode one. Do you remember that, Joe?
Like I was saying, the only thing I remember is Bob Ross, happy little clouds, and an orange sky. That's about the last thing I remember.
Did you remember some of the colors he said? A titanium white. You remember that?
Did he beat the Dickens out of his brush on his on his.
Yeah. Oh, he was. He loves that pounding. Part. He was pounding that big wide brush he had.
Oh, he loves doing that. He always says that that's his favorite part.
Yeah. Joe, we were watching it, and he described what he was going to do. He said he was doing like a sunset, over the ocean, line with rocks, and he's just painting like purple circles. And Joe's like, "Just watch it, man. It's all sun." He says purple circle, all of a sudden it's just going to fucking click and you're going to see it and it's going to be amazing. You're going to see it, dude. Trust me. I'm like, all right.
This is drunk Kelk talking?
Yeah, this is drunk Kelk. And also, he's like, you know what? I'm going to tweet out Bob Ross.
Nice.
Dude's been dead for like 15 years.
I bet you he's got like, a page, though, or a Twitter account.
Probably, but it was pretty fun. And even his Twitter that Kelk sent out was not right at all either, so he just did hashtag Bob. We also watched Fuller House for 2 minutes and then turned it off, and then we watched that's the movie, The Do-Over with Adam Sandler.
Did we really watch part of Fuller House?
Yeah, we did for 2 minutes.
I don't remember that. All right,
get
all.
That Do-Over out of here. That's movies.
Yeah,
that's a TV
yeah, that's
talk.
Movies. Sorry. But yeah, Joe doesn't even remember that either.
I do. I watched that.
You watched the whole movie?
Yeah. It's hilarious.
And what do you think?
It was great.
From what I saw of it, it was pretty... I liked the very beginning when they're at the reunion and the wife's dancing with the
ex-husband.
The college... the high school sweetheart. Dude, oh, come on.
The whole movie is just awesome. Man.
Yeah.
Speaking of Fuller House, Fuller House is reportedly one of the most watched television shows of 2016 and may even have more viewers than AMC's The Walking Dead.
Whoa.
That is crazy talk. Within the first week alone, it managed to pull in 10 million viewers, putting it just behind The Walking Dead's 12.1 million viewer count.
That's crazy.
I bet they're going to be asking for some major bankroll for the next season.
I don't know. I mean, it could be skewed, too, because don't they put out all of the season?
Yeah, all at once.
Yeah, well, all at once. Mm-hmm. So,
it was very nostalgic too. So I think that's why it got a lot of like views. I mean, myself and my wife, we had a good time watching the first couple episodes, and my son got into it. He thought it was funny, but I think I kind of stopped watching after fifth or sixth episode.
Jody Sweden,
Celtic beer thoughts.
It's really good. I'm actually drinking it slow tonight and trying to enjoy it.
Okay,
get some of the flavors. It has very much like the orange citrus to balance out that hoppy grapefruit flavor.
Mm-hmm.
But it, again, it's got some very high level burn to it as well.
Right.
Okay. So that or the 90?
As of right now, I'm actually enjoying this a lot. I know in the past I've said I like the 90 more because it's a little bit more smooth as far as acidic and the burn. But this one's real nice being able to like just sip it slow.
Pitch.
All
right. Did you get food pairing?
Yeah, what's your food pairing?
Ooh, food pairing.
Alka-Seltzer.
No, you know what? I'm gonna go to go with the citrus and the bourbon burn a little bit. I would say, as I call it, I'd go for that nice spicy rack of ribs we had during E3.
Mm-hmm. Pitch, your thoughts?
It's a nay for me. It's got a good taste, but the taste is kind of too, I guess it's like that whiskey aftertaste
that
I'm not enjoying. It's a nay.
Myself, I'm a yay. This actually has got some really good flavor, and I would say as much as I like Guinness, I think it actually compares very well to a Guinness.
You were saying nay in the beginning, right? You said you didn't like it too much?
No, I said maybe it was super smooth. I didn't pour it into the glass yet either, I think, when I was saying that too. So, but it is really good, and like I said, the flavor is just there. There's a little bit more flavor to it than I think a Guinness actually brings to the table. The Guinness is like super smooth and it's just like a good beer taste. But for some reason, there's like a little bit of flavor in this one that I'm just really enjoying. So I definitely say yay. All right, we're going to take a break and we'll come back to you with some E3 talk in the Let's Talk Games section.
Are you tired of hearing this?
This is boring. What are we playing? This sucks.
And you're kind of in luck, sort of. Our new game, A Box of Rocks with a Fox and Socks.
Yay!
You stand up the box, fill it with dirty socks, which are provided, a bunch of rocks, probably from your leftover rock soup recipe, and last but not least, a fox. Reach in and hope you don't grab the fox. Fox not included. All bodily harm is at your own risk.
All right, we're back with Let's.
Let's talk.
Games. All right, let's get started off with what we played. Celtic, what'd you play?
Got a little bit of Flame in the Flood in there when you guys were over for like five minutes.
Watch you play it.
Yeah. Have my dog go nuts when ever the dog on the game barks. And other than that, Overwatch, Pigeon got some Overwatch time in, and him and I would take turns. It's a really fun game.
Yeah, it's fun. I enjoy it, but I don't know how long I would enjoy it for.
Yeah, but I think you like it as a pickup game. I think, you know.
Yeah, but I'd rather play FIFA with you guys than Overwatch.
I don't know. I'm torn on that. I mean, I really like the FIFA, but
yeah, Overwatch, I really like Overwatch and FIFA both. But I can't say if I like Overwatch playing with friends because nobody plays with me.
You poor baby. No,
I'll get on that. Pigeon's gonna have to pick it up, or he'll play something else.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Pigeon, what'd you play?
I played some FIFA 16, a little bit of Overwatch.
Me too.
Yeah, and like Celtic said, I had to watch Celtic play the Flame in the Flood for 5 minutes.
All right. E3 recap, Sony news. Trailer revealed for new God of War. Is it Norse mythology?
It didn't look Norse to me, but everyone's saying that.
Pushing it.
Yeah, but it didn't look like it was Norse mythology.
Right. I would have figured it would have been a lot darker, a little bit more snowy, maybe, and I don't know, maybe not, but.
But wasn't there? I mean, there was a dragon flying by. Was there dragons in Norse mythology? I didn't think so.
Was Khaleesi on it?
Khaleesi, what is it? Queen of dragons or mother of dragons?
Yeah. What is that? The unburnt.
Yeah. I don't know. It looked impressive, visually impressive.
Yeah, it surprised me. And then after I'd seen it, I was really impressed with it. I mean, I'd like to play it.
I know we're going to talk about Rise and how it compared to a different game, but God of War reminds me of Rise. It's like a quick time event, you know, smash buttons until you kill the guy, and then when he gets to the final blow, then you do like a quick time event. I don't know why people hate on Rise when it's the same thing.
Oh, well, we'll definitely talk about that later, because
I know. I mean, I enjoyed Rise. Argument here? It was a good game to release with the console.
Yeah, no, that was. I mean, graphically, it definitely, I think, pushed the console for, you know,
yeah,
the graphic end of things to sell it as being the next gen console that it is.
Yeah.
Sony Bend Studio unveils a post-apocalyptic biker game, Days Gone.
That looked good. That looked really good.
That's their answer to what? Dead Rising / State of Decay.
Okay.
I wouldn't even say Dead Rising. Dead Rising is kind of like a Saints Row to a GTA. It's kind of like the funny zombie game.
Yeah. True. Okay.
So I would liken this to, I don't know, like The Last of Us.
Yeah, you know what? You're right.
State of Decay. I haven't played State of Decay, but, you know, comparing to the zombie genre, then it's more serious.
Yeah, it looked like Norman Reedus in State of Decay.
Norman Reedus' brother. But that game looked good. Scott, what did you think of it? You didn't say it, did you?
No, I watched the whole Sony thing. Huh? I'm not 100% sold on the whole apocalyptic games right now. I don't know why. I just can't get into it. It seems like maybe I'm just overwhelmed by the amount of them that have already been released and that, you know, continue to be released, and I'm kind of worn out by it.
I think I'm with you. I like more like funnier post-apocalyptic games like Dead Rising. I like that, putting a big dildo in someone's face or something like that. Like the serious ones, I'll leave that for like The Last of Us and, you know, whatever other game.
Right.
I think graphically, it's impressive, and the amount of zombies coming after you was really impressive.
Yeah, that was pretty crazy. That was the it had like that element of parkour to it and stuff, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. The Last Guardian is finally coming, October 25th.
Oh my gosh, people were in an uproar. If this game gets less than a 10 out of 10, that's disappointing then.
calling it right now, it's going to get like a 7.5.
Oh, of I was going to give it like an 8.3.
I'll give it a 6. No, it's going to get at least a 7 just because of the name alone.
Yeah, but this was one of my predictions where I actually thought this game was going to slip, but it's good to see it didn't.
Yeah.
Detroit. Become Human's story is a web of choices. In Detroit, Become Human, you'll collect information investigating murder scenes and face life and death dilemmas that will force you to make smart choices and affect the narrative in a variety of ways. This is the one that was kind of seemed, to me, it looked like it was going to be a short game, but it was going to be something that you could play over and over and over again just to make the different decisions.
Yeah, with this... Right. This reminded me a lot of what were their two games? Until Dawn and Heavy Rain?
No, they did Heavy Rain and Beyond Two Souls or something like that. Okay. The one with Ellen Page.
Okay, that's right. That's right. But it looked really, really good. And I liked the whole play out the narrative different ways.
Yeah, the trailer was cool because it showed one way and then it kept on doing the flashback, and it showed you at least, what, 6 to 7 different ways that will happen?
Yeah.
Yeah, and my wife watched this with Pigeon and I.
Oh, yeah, she liked it.
She really liked it. She was into it.
There's another one that is big right now, Hitman. Have you seen the Hitman game at all, guys?
Yeah, it's like kill how you want to kill them or something like that.
Right, but then there's different options for, like, different things that you have to do, different people that you have to kill and stuff like that to figure or to not finish the game. I mean, you can just play it once, play through, the one option killing and be done with it. But that's going to have, that has like this, every time there's a new episode that they release, it's once a week or once every other week that they do a release of this.
Right, a different episode.
Right. Do you think that might have something to do, or that might be kind of along this line with Us Become Humans story?
I don't know.
What, you mean like more episodic?
Well, because I was saying, with it having multiple choices, it seemed like it was going to be a shorter game from what they showed. It seemed like maybe that was just one episode that you can go through and make the choices different times. And maybe
I think it's going to be a longer game.
Okay.
It could be episodic, but it's, I mean, Pigeon's right. It's probably one of these games that's going to fall into the... I've been hearing a couple mumbles of it during E3 from tweets and interviews that people kind of are looking for the shorter games, like the 6 to 8 hour games instead of the 15
like
to 20. Yeah, like me. So this, I don't know, did you guys play the Beyond Two Souls and the Heavy Rain? I mean, was that more than like a 6 hour game?
I'm not sure. I never played them, but they got okay reviews, but just kind of like the storytelling was what was good. I think this game's more of like an Until Dawn. You know, you have consequences for what happens.
Right.
And it can go different ways.
Resident Evil 7 announced. Demo available now.
Yeah, I downloaded it.
You think Sony pulled PT because of this game? Or?
Well, now that I see it and how it's very similar to PT, I think so.
Right.
Yeah, well, exactly. It's like, why continue to sink money like on a first-party front into a game like PT when you have something very similar from a third party, like as in Resident Evil.
I don't know, but that trailer was awesome. Your wife couldn't even watch it, Calc.
Yeah, she turned her head and laid on the floor because she couldn't stand looking at the the different flashing scenes.
What you think of it, Scotch?
From what I remember, it looks good. And I mean, again, I'm not into the whole horror genre of gaming for some reason. I'll play them. It's not something I usually go after, so it's probably not something that I will play from, you know, watching the trailer and stuff. But I thought it looked, again, I think a lot of the games that were released, I thought they all looked decent. There was maybe a handful that were just like, eh. But this one definitely, like you said, it could be a good reason as to why they pulled PT. I think it was more of the reason that they were having a falling out with
Kojima and Guillermo. Yeah. Why don't you should download the demo in case they pull it from the store.
So what do you guys think if we were to some magical way, whether Sony listens or wants to send us a VR headset, would you actually try this?
Oh yeah.
In the VR, do you think you could handle the horror?
No, I might have a heart attack.
That's funny because I was talking to Brett about this. I was watching his Twitch channel last night, and I said to him, I was like, I tweeted you out because I thought you had done some of those casts where, you know, you wear the heart monitor and stuff and show it on screen while you're playing horror movies or games. Sorry, not movies, games. And I was wondering if he was going to try out this one, and he said he didn't think he'd be able to with the VR.
Yeah, I'd probably shit my pants. I have my
I don't know how I'm going to do with VR, like, just in general. I think it's going to... I'm scared of heights as it is. So even games like Minecraft, where you're really hot, really high up, I'm going to have a tough time with that. A game like Resident Evil 7 with the horror, I don't know if I'd be able to handle it.
Mm. Yeah.
Speaking of VR, PlayStation VR to be released in October. And they put a, they put a price tag on it of $399.
What do you think?
I think that's a lot lower than the others that are coming out right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was going to say, I think it's a good price point. It just makes me question the quality and how good is it really going
to
be?
I definitely question the quality similar to you, Kuk, but I think this is going to steal a lot of that market because of the price point.
Yeah, I mean, people, what, 40 million people already have the PS4?
Right.
And they don't have to go out and buy a PC rig and the Vive or the Oculus.
Right.
They can just, they already have their PS4, they just buy this.
No, exactly, but it also makes you think about the whole talk about the PlayStation Neo being needed to make the VR successful. So it's going to be very interesting to see how
the next couple of months,
how the first run PS4s handle this lower priced VR headset. I mean, is it going to fall short a little bit of expectations from people? I mean, people are doing it right now at E3 and saying it's really cool. But I think when you start to see some of the quality come out of the Oculus and the HTC, maybe Sony will just be a couple steps too short.
I think they'll be a couple steps too short only on time until the Neo releases. But I still think the price point with regards to the Neo and their VR headset, I think it's still going to... I think it's still going to take a bunch of the market.
I'm going to also throw out there, like I think I said a couple episodes ago, my prediction is they're going to do a $799 bundle for a Neo and the VR headset.
Mm. We'll see if it holds true.
Gameplay trailer for Horizon Zero Dawn shows off combat and environments.
Looks gorgeous. I mean, I was sold on it, you know, from the way back teaser. It just looks good. Mm-hmm. I want to know more of the story.
Yeah, it's one of those ones from last year that took me right out of the gate. I was excited to see it. Right.
And the main character is hot too.
That's Dreads and all for you, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Star Wars, Batman, and Final Fantasy franchises come to PlayStation VR.
Mm. This is going to be a trend. I mean, I'll try to keep it real short. This is a trend that kind of concerns me with the, hey, let's just slap a VR segment onto something.
With a license name or something.
Yeah, and get it out there and maybe leave some bad tastes in people's mouth rather than take the time and do something from scratch and make it really high quality.
It's just that initial games that come out. That's what these are. It's kind of like bloatware.
That said,
all console releases and stuff.
Yeah, that said, the Star Wars, I think it was like their X-Wing missions looked really cool.
Now, do you think, and this is kind of just a crazy tin hat or tinfoil hat thought, do you think Sony was throwing some money at them just to do options in these games and stuff, just to have a good number of games to release with the VR headset when it comes out in October?
I don't. What I think is, they already have games on the PS4, so they already have the tech behind it. Mm-hmm. So let's just throw some kind of 1 to 2 hour kind of, you know, in quotes, tech demo and sell it for like $20.
Yeah, no, I agree with that, but I still think Scotchy's right. There might have been some backdoor dealing because, I mean, take example, the Star Wars. Sony got the rights to have their system plastered in the DLC all over the whole Star Wars when that came out. Mm-hmm. So I guarantee there was something, you know, along the lines of, hey, we got this VR. Since we're locking up this deal, can we maybe get something pushed, you know, specifically for our VR?
Right.
So, yeah, I think that might have happened.
Yeah.
Speaking of Star Wars, Star Wars Battlefront X-Wing VR mission will have you take on the role of an X-Wing pilot to travel through space and fight off the other ships. The VR game will be free on PlayStation 4 for those who already own Battlefront.
That's pretty cool.
It is. But I think Scotchy nailed it when he said a little bit bigger, but basically like VR demos is what these are going to be.
Right.
Yeah.
And the Batman VR for Rocksteady will allow players to equip Batman's famed weapons and tools, such as the grapple gun and Batarang. And it will feature narrative-driven investigation sequences.
That could be pretty cool, depending on, you know, how much of an immersion or an experience it is.
Right. The thing I was going to say about, and we might talk about this later in that, is I saw one of the, I can't remember which game it was talking, or showed us where they actually showed the VR gameplay. It might have been a computer demo that we were watching when we watched the PC things, and they were showing a shooter. And all it ever showed was the guns kind of hovering out in space. So it didn't
Serious
have arms
Sam.
Attached to it. Yeah, that's what it was. And it didn't have the arms attached to it. And I'm hoping that that's not the typical of the VR.
Yeah, I know what it you're saying. That they need to ground it in some way. They need to ground the weaponry to yourself as the experience.
Right.
I think a floating weapon takes you out of the experience.
Right, yeah, exactly. In Final Fantasy 15, or XV, your party goes against a behemoth. You can warp around the battlefield, and the move controller is used in combat for aiming.
Who cares? Watching it,
like, I don't know if it was just as difficult as, you know, I thought it looked, just because the guy that was playing it on stage didn't look like he was that.
Yeah, Pigeon, I was listening to the Kind of Funny Guys, their podcast, and
let me guess, they're in love with it.
No, your buddy Colin Moriarty was tearing this apart. He was saying he didn't realize how much Final Fantasy was like a boy band, you know, doing the missions and stuff. He was tearing it up pretty good. So if you get a chance, check it out and listen to that episode on their recap.
I just don't understand why people love the Final Fantasy series. It just looks stupid.
I think it's not so much that they're into the gameplay as a whole. I think it's the story.
Either way, if you disagree with me, tweet me at Pigeon Peg Leg or at The Loaded Couch on Twitter, because nice. I think Final Fantasy sucks.
Mm-hmm. Or find his Reddit account, because he seems to get quite the hate on Reddit.
Yeah, which is Pigeon Peg Leg as well.
Impulse Gear shows off new VR shooter, Farpoint. It's a PlayStation 4 exclusive. Shows your character scanning the environment, avoiding what look like drones, getting into firefights, and facing off against a massive spider-like monster.
Yeah, I don't know.
But I've been hearing positive things about this one on Twitter. I've been seeing a lot of people are happy with it.
Was this a spider monster that also looked like it was a mix between a spider and a crab?
You're thinking about Scalebound, I think.
I don't remember it because Joe was sleeping halfway through the conference.
Well, I was watching, like, I think I tweeted out a comment about this, that it seemed on most of the monster battling games that there was like a spider crab kind of, I don't know, theme.
Yeah, they always go for the giant arachnid. Always seems to be the focal point.
Right. Okay.
Especially for Final Fantasy games.
Here's the woot woot portion. Crash Bandicoot is coming back on PS4. Exactly. Crash Bandicoot 1, 2, and 3 are being made remade for the PS4. And when I say, or when it says remade, I'm assuming it's actually being
remastered and not just remade.
Right.
I thought they were remasters, though, because I think this kills Pigeon's under right out of the gate.
No, it doesn't. No, because this is 3 here. We don't know if it's all one package, first of all. That'll be 1 then.
Oh, well, I'm not giving you all as one package. It's just one.
What if it comes out as one package?
I don't care. This is 1, 2, okay. and 3.
Now, so what if, how would,
and then Skyrim is 4.
How would
What's
Rare
the other ones?
Pulling that? The Rare Replay, how would that have pulled as one?
That would have been 20.
No, 30. But so that's 4. That's only 4 remasters, right?
Yeah.
Unless you could think of another one. And I said over, under 4.5, and I said under, so I'm right.
All right, we'll have to check it out.
Yeah, fuck you.
So you're, so it is remastered. Like I said, I think they said they were rebuilding the game, so graphically it looked a lot more impressive on the PS4.
What's the big deal about Crash Bandicoot?
It's a good platformer. I mean, from what I'd seen, I think it was along the lines of one of those first that used the 3D kind of walking into the screenplay.
Yeah, it was like along the lines of the whole Mario 64 and the Banjo-Kazooie and Crash Bandicoot stuff.
So this
like that.
Is this is that the fox character that has no neck.
Yes, it's like all it goes right from head into his body. And
yeah,
arms.
He's like all mouth and smile.
Yeah, exactly.
He pretty much just shoulder shrugs until his neck was gone.
Yep. Yeah, pretty much.
Okay. Okay.
Kind of like The Rock.
Oh my gosh, so amazing.
Lego Star Wars Force Awakens demo available on PSN right now.
Yeah, I downloaded it. I'm going to have my daughter and I play it. Check it out.
Did you guys see my tweet on that?
No, I didn't. What'd you say?
I said, look, Star Wars looks pretty good in Lego. I said that might be a money-saving option for them on their next movies.
It does look really good.
Yeah, that would be pretty cool. Dude, what if in like 10 years from now they come out with in theaters like Lego Star Wars The Force Awakens? The movie.
They're doing Legos. That Batman movie, the Lego Batman movie.
First try.
Yeah, that was the best part. New Spider-Man PS4 title announced from Insomniac Games, and that was an exclusive, wasn't it?
It was, and this could be really good. I mean, yeah. look at Sunset Overdrive.
Exactly. You just took the words out of my mouth. This is going to be you heard it here first. This is going to be a great game. Finally, a Spider-Man game that's done right.
Kojima astounds with PS4 title Death Stranding.
Oh my gosh, Kojima!
I mean, everybody like blew a load when he came walking down the stage. With the,
I was
like
more
the
impressed
lights
with
following
the
him stuff. It looked like Michael Jackson's video where every time he took a step, it lit up.
Billie Jean. It's for the children.
Of course, he's got Norman Reedus in there because he just sells everything, or as Jim likes to call him, Norman Fetus.
Well, that's what people on Reddit was calling him, Norman Fetus game. Mm-hmm. He was crying because his fetus was gone.
The demo, I guess, that they showed was from in-game footage with Sony tech guru Mark Cerny?
Cerny,
okay. With the game's tech producer.
If that's real in-game footage, that's pretty impressive.
It did look pretty good.
And you know the budget on that and that game's going to be like $1 billion.
Yeah,
and they're not using, and from what I think I recall, they're not using Kojima's Fox Engine, right?
Konami owns that.
Yeah, so I think they're just probably going to use something like Unreal 4 or something like that.
No, I bet he's going to build his own engine.
Why not, right?
Oh, I hope not, though. It'll take another 8 years.
So, Celtic, what was your prediction? This game's going to come out when? 2020?
Yeah, exactly. This is like a CG trailer for
Project Neo 2.
For Ellen DeGeneres' Green Eggs and Ham.
Dude, we only got a year and a half to go, so we're almost there.
And Microsoft news, you can now design your own custom Xbox One controller.
That's pretty cool, man.
For the low price of, what was it, $80?
They're going to sell tons of these things.
Yeah, $79.99. But, depending on what you want,
That was the colors only, $79.99. I think if you wanted them engraved with your name or your gamer tag or whatever on it, it was an extra, $10?
Yeah, yeah. And I think it's probably more money if you want to color the buttons or the thumbsticks or something.
No, I think the color choice, regardless of the combinations, was $79, and it said specifically the laser etching was the extra $10.
How soon before you can do this with the Elite controller?
I think
it's the next step.
Know.
It's just clip-on parts at this
point.
Yeah,
I think it's the next step for sure, but
especially if it's just the outside body.
Speaking of, that Gears controller looks pretty hot.
I'm not a fan of it.
Isn't the new, just kind of jumping ahead real quick, isn't the new S modeled controller that comes with the system, isn't that have the same grip on the backside of the controller?
Yeah, the texture grips, yes.
Right, so again, if those controllers that they're selling now with the color options are going to have the textured grip back to it, it's all the same clip-on plastic parts on the outside body,
well,
so why not?
So are you guys interested in a custom controller with the new grip back, or would you spend the extra, what are we talking, $60 for the Elite?
extra.
Well, I have the Elite. I do the Elite. Kelsey, just so you know, the Gears of War 4 limited edition controller.
It's like 200 bucks. Super limited, I heard. Yep.
$200 and it's stupid. The only reason I like it is the blackout jewel button.
Exactly, and that's
things
from
like a spotlight.
I watched the interview with Rod Ferguson, and it's one of them things for people that have the money just to buy it and have it on display, not even use it.
Yeah, right, Pitch. If you want, just next time you come up, I'll get out the painter's tape and we'll just spray paint your jewel to black it out.
Okay, sure. On my Elite too.
Yeah, exactly. Yep. Yeah. Crackdown 3 delayed until 2017. Awesome. Okay. Boo.
Just get the horrible game right. Yeah. That's it.
Now, do you think that was a delay for Scorpio?
I read the article on it. I think it was released this morning on the actual Crackdown site, or it was yesterday, and they specifically said yes, it's because they felt the game needs a lot more added to it, a lot more polish. It's not in the shape that they want to present people with.
Is it a horsepower thing too, or is it more just
the word,
game development?
It's probably in the words of Biff, you need more horsepower. Yeah.
You can't do that without power.
Yeah, they need the Scorpio. Yeah.
And you know what? This is the one game I'm okay with them delaying.
Yeah, but oh man, boy, do I love those Crackdown games.
ReCore costs $40, supports cross-play, cross-buy with Xbox Anywhere, and it's releasing on September 13th.
Yeah, Xbox Play Anywhere is if you buy it on Xbox One, you get it on the PC. If you buy it on PC, you get it on the Xbox One,
yep.
I'm guessing.
You buy it once, and you can play it on both Xbox and PC.
Now that it costs $40, it seems to me that it's kind of like a shorter game. It's not a more in-depth game.
Right.
Which leads me to believe that it's not going to be as good as everyone thought it would be.
Yeah, or like limited production quality. So maybe Pigeon, I think you and I were talking about this. We were a little concerned before we even saw it because of what happened with, what was it, Mighty No. 9?
Oh my God, the dude who's doing that game part of this game. But the people who worked on the Metroid games, it kind of reminds me of a Metroid game a little bit, the platforming of it.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, but you could be right. Maybe this is one of those, you know, 10-hour games or less.
See, that's what I was going to say. Instead of it being a lower production, maybe it's just a lower or a shorter gameplay, a shorter story.
So what do you think? Downloadable only, or it's getting a hard copy?
I think it gets a hard copy.
Yeah, I was gonna say, I think both.
I bet you if they put out like a limited edition one that you could. Oh, I think they did. I think they said if you pay like instead of $40, there's like a $129, you know, collector's edition where you get like the animal or something.
Know what though, too? This could be one of those return on investment like tests where if they sell this thing and it does a lot better than they expect, maybe we'll see a ReCore 2, you know, 4 years down the road.
On the Scorpio.
Right.
Yep. At $69.99, because that's what the game prices are going to be soon.
Yeah, of course. Project Scorpio, speaking of, unveiled. Coming holiday 2017.
Celtic's boner was never bigger after this was unveiled.
I was tired of hearing it, but I'm going to say it myself. 6 teraflops of processing power.
How many?
Shut up. compared to the current Xbox One's mere 1.31 teraflops.
What does the PS4 have?
1.5 or 1.4.
See, I was
going
to say,
like
I knew
that.
It had to be better than the Xbox
1.8.
That was the big selling point. Is it
1.8? Is that what it is?
Yeah, almost 2. So it's 1.8. It's better than Xbox One.
Yep.
And the 6 teraflops will be accompanied with a much improved 320 gigabyte per second of memory bandwidth.
That's a lot.
I'm going to see how much the PS4 has.
It's less than 200. They said the Neo is going to be bumped to like 205.
140.
Yep.
Current PS4.
Currently, yes. Yeah, okay. And what does Xbox One have currently?
210. Because it has that ES RAM.
Yeah, I don't know. It's something.
For 1080p at 60 frames per second, Microsoft says their system is more than enough, or has more than enough hardware to push the VR headset and run regular games at 4K resolution with support for high dynamic range.
Now, some people are questioning this 4K resolution, if it's like compressed or uncompressed.
Up-resed and all that other crap.
Yeah, so I don't know if it's true. Excuse me, I don't know if it's true 4K or not. So
no, the article and the video, it tells you it's uncompressed native 4K.
Yeah, I thought that's what Phil was saying when he was talking about it. Okay, we'll here we go again. I have to mention it again. Jeez, compare that 6 teraflops figure to the existing graphics card for the PC. The AMD R9 390X pushes around 5.9 teraflops, but the card struggles with 4K at 30 frames per second. Even a top tier R9 Fury X or 10 is 8.4 teraflops, or the NVIDIA GTX 1080 is 9 teraflops, just barely scraped by.
I'm looking up how much it costs for that that first AMD Radeon.
Yeah, the new AMD they announced is $199.
Oh, it's $199?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and that was the indicator that they think Microsoft buys enough of these chips in bulk that
down to like $150 or something.
Yeah, and again, that's part of the argument. Microsoft themselves have said this is going to be a more elite, expensive console. If I had to guess, I bet this thing's going to come in at like $699.
That would kill them, dude. That would just kill them. Dude, we were talking about this. Two things. One, the price point, and two is they're talking about this thing a year and a half away. So by the time it's a year and a half away, the parts will be common and be obsolete, right?
I don't know about obsolete, but I mean, they're going to try their best to keep it pretty current. Because,
well, I was going to say, that was my argument when they announced it now, being so far away, is they're putting specs out now for what it's going to have when, if technology continues to grow the way it does, within a year, then maybe they could do 12 teraflops.
Yeah, so instead of 6, why not 9?
But then maybe the price point, maybe I am wrong. Maybe the price point's going to be, in 18 months, maybe the price point's going to be $399 or $499, and there is going to be a 12 teraflop system. But obviously, nobody's going to pay the $800 for the 12 teraflops.
Mm. Yeah. So either way, this was a bold kind of reveal by Microsoft, I think, to come out with this, to talk about the console and its specs.
Yeah, but I was reading a lot of other articles too. They think one of the reasons Sony decided not to show the Neo was, at first, the rumor
was
leaks
underperforming than this.
Well, yeah, a lot of the rumor leaks they thought were exaggerated and not possible, but then they think as far back as a week ago they caught wind that it was true, and they decided to pull the Neo from even talking about it because they realized they're just not going to be able to compete with it. And some people are saying right now, oh well, Sony will just go and change their specs, but supposedly the Neo has already been set and agreed, and contracts have been signed because the Neo is supposed to come out next year in the spring. And they think it's already being, supposedly the development kits have already been sent out to game companies. So they think Sony's in a really big pickle right now because they've committed and they're on their way with this Neo, and Microsoft just pretty much threw down their, you know, their trump card and said,
either way, PS4 has the jump 2-1. Trump card. Trump, why not a Clinton card?
on that, join
speaking
the
of
battlefield.
Clinton.
No, Halo Wars 2, February 21st. Is that a 2017 release?
Yes, 2017. The open beta has already started, and if you play one game in Halo Wars 2 beta, you get a bunch of rec packs for Halo 5.
Oh, nice.
Cool.
All right. Did you guys, I'll piggyback on this real quick. Did you guys see that Phil announced we're a couple months away from keyboard and mouse support?
Yeah, I saw that.
So that's another point for me.
State of Decay 2 announced. The trailer looked good. I was curious if it was going to be excited. A tighter close-up third-person shooter or not.
Yeah, it's all CG. We don't know.
Because the original was more of a, what would you say, like a Diablo third-person calc?
I don't think it was that far back, but I mean, I think this next one's going to be right there with like your Quantum Break and The Division, like up a little closer.
Right.
Do you remember, like, I actually, besides the pop in and some of the frame rate issues, the first State of Decay was pretty impressive looking on the 360.
I heard the 360 one was really buggy, but when they ported it over the State of Decay to the Xbox One, it was a lot better. It needed the extra horsepower.
Yep. Exactly.
Also,
but it looked really well. So State of Decay 2 might be pretty impressive.
Also, it's an Xbox One Windows 10 exclusive.
Well, to that point, I think we could echo to anybody listening. I think every game shown from this point forward was the Xbox One Windows 10 exclusive cross-play, cross-buy.
Right.
Play anywhere.
Yep.
Scalebound, also coming to Windows 10 PC with cross-buy and cross-play.
Pump it up! And put my headphones on and fight a dragon!
Yeah, I'm probably going to super excited about this.
Yeah.
He was, and then he got cold, and then when he saw the trailer, he was like, okay, Final Fantasy 15 clone. Next.
Yeah, I'm probably going to take heat. This thing's fallen off my radar. I'm not excited for this one.
Yeah. How about the next one? Are you excited for it?
I am. It's my game of E3 as far as like originality. I mean, it's not too original, but it's from what they've shown, it's very well done.
What is it? What is it, Mr. Host?
Sea of Thieves gameplay trailer was shown. Now, the thing that I was concerned about, Celtic, and we can talk about this. sorry. The gameplay showed the entire crew, and that was 4 players, say, on each team.
I don't know.
That were running a ship. I'm going to say it was approximately 4 players.
Yeah, it was 4 to 5, I think, right, from what I've read.
Now, my concern with it is, are you going to be able to do anything if you're the only one of your friends that's on without having to join like a crew of somebody else? Or is it
maybe
something
like
that
give
you have
commands,
to schedule?
Give commands to your, what is it called, Drivatar?
So your big question is, can you hop in and play this by yourself?
Yes.
I'm sure you could.
I would be willing to bet. I don't think you can. I think this is meant to be a
party game.
Party. It's a little bit short of calling it an MMO, but I think it definitely requires you to participate with other people.
Right. Okay. That's what I was thinking when I watched it.
My thoughts is this game is getting so much positive attention with so little that's shown,
mm-hmm,
that people's hopes are going to be so high and the bar is going to be set so high that if it's anything less than what they thought it was, it's going to do so bad.
Or at least it'll just get the bad reviews from it.
Yeah, and it's like, oh man, look at that trailer. Like, you could be a pirate and this, do that, search treasure. And then when the game comes out, it's like, yeah, you could do that, but it's slow. There's long load times. There's this, there's that. I'm weary that it's not going to meet expectations. That's right. My scare.
I mean, some of the articles, the tweets, the things coming out of E3, I mean, everybody who's played it say, as little bit of a slice as it is, it's very impressive.
Yes.
In so many ways.
That's the key, the slice.
I'm curious how big the world's going to be.
Yeah. Maybe it's 1-to-1 for the Pacific and the Atlantic Ocean. Who knows?
Frank West is back in Dead Rising 4.
Oh, I love it. I love Dead Rising games, man.
I think I'll actually have to pick this one up with you guys. Watching you guys dork out. I don't remember who was riding on the back of the motorcycle. But
Calc was.
That was me and my little tennis shorts.
Yeah, your tennis outfit. You look like Bjorn Bjork or something like that, whatever his name is.
I might have to grab this one.
And I think this one, it might have been the early leaks, but I don't know if they talked about it. This one, I think, is a 4-player co-op.
Yeah, I hope it is, because the only one, it was 2-player before. If it's 4-player co-op, that's amazing, man.
Game set to release around Christmas 2016.
Yep. Oh, I can't wait.
Tekken 7 coming in 2017. Tekken Tag Tournament 2 is free for limited time. It's this week only. Hopefully you download
it. Yeah, it's a backwards compatible game.
Right.
But so, Tekken 7 trailer took so long. It got real boring fast.
Yeah, so we got, what, two... We're going to have two solid fighting games then. Yeah,
what, Killer Instinct?
Killer Instinct, yeah. Killer Instinct and this. Oh, actually, and then Injustice, I think. So, be three.
Okay. Yeah. Well, Injustice isn't exclusive though, right?
No, not
exclusive. As well as, Tekken 7's cross-platform, to, or multi-console as well, correct?
Good question. Yeah, I could take sure a look at that. Okay. I'll come back to you.
We Happy Few gameplay trailer was shown.
This game looks awesome.
Now, it only comes first to Xbox One, and it will be on the Xbox Game Preview Program on July 22nd, 26th.
I made fun of Celtic doing the Elite Dangerous preview, because Elite Dangerous looks stupid, but this game... I will definitely do the preview program.
I was just gonna ask you guys, would you guys support this one on the preview?
Because I love the BioShock games, and it just reminds me of BioShock.
Yeah, totally, completely.
Yeah, this was so eerie when she's like, "Oh, you didn't take your joy pill." Right. I was like, "Oh man, this game's dark."
Especially at the end, what was it like? He was like hurting the boy or something like that, and he comes over and like looks at you and smiles and just shuts the curtains.
He's hurting the boy and he gives him the needle, and then the boy turns and looks and smiles and waves.
Oh yeah.
And then he comes over, yeah, and then the
pinata, which is
the pinata scene. Yeah, that was awesome.
Yeah, it's just creepy. But anyway, Tekken 7, I think it's all consoles.
Okay. Gwent digital card game announced.
Yeah, who cares? It's in the game already, so who cares?
That's the thing. They had some improvements on it, though.
They did, but I mean, this goes with the Bethesda with the Elder Scrolls card game. Mm-hmm. They're kind of that top down, you know, just animated card where you take games like Hearthstone and the Fable Fortunes game. Oh, they're card combat, but they use characters and animations and little mini board environments. I'm not a big fan of just the straight up flat card on the digital surface.
You like a little bit more?
Yeah. I think they had the potential there. I mean, Gwent was in the game already, like Pigeon said, and it's really solid. I mean, why not take it to the next level?
Right, pretty it up.
Yeah.
Minecraft goes cross-platform.
That's pretty huge, dude.
And I mean, that was crazy cross-platform. I mean, it wasn't the one... girl playing it on her iPad.
Yeah, it was.
Well, somebody was playing on. You could play on iPad, an iPhone,
Android,
an Android phone, a Xbox PC. I don't know if you could do PS4 to Xbox One yet. I wonder if that'd be pretty cool if you could just do all consoles.
Either way, though, Scott, yeah, like I said, this null and voids pretty much our old Minecraft that's built on Java, yeah, right.
Windows 10.
Yeah, that like everything going forward is this new Windows 10
Pocket
operating. Yeah, the Pocket. The steroid Pocket Edition is what they run on the Windows 10. So I think our old server may be a lost cause.
Yeah.
We got to play more Minecraft. I enjoy that game. That's a time killer. For Father's Day, I'm going to play that all day.
Oh, and also for our listeners, the Minecraft, also they're adding the realms. So basically you can rent out like a server or the realm, and you don't need to have your friends online to participate in that world.
See, that might be something that, like you said, Celtic, we dropped the old server, which sucks. I mean, maybe
start a new one.
Maybe
start a new one.
If you do drop it, make sure you just do a save as and send me the file.
Yeah, I'll try and find a way to export it. I should try and do that this month.
Let's do a realm. Let's start
building. Yeah. Okay.
Yep.
Xbox Live adding new clubs, tournament features, and more. With clubs, players can form communal groups to find gamers with common interests. Looking for group is essentially a want ad over Xbox Live, as you are able to put out a message to find players with common goals.
I don't know if you guys ever did that. I did the looking for group for Destiny.
That was a separate app, though, right?
Yeah, it was a separate app, and essentially what you do is someone posts like, "Hey, I need, you know, three players for the Nightfall, or two players for the Nightfall, I'm at the boss." And then you would just message them. There's a button, you message them through the Xbox app or through the program. And you send them a message and it would pop up like, you know, you know, and you've just been invited to the party and to join the game.
Right.
Yeah, no, this is key. I think this is going to really do well once it's introduced and people learn how to use it.
It'd be cool if they introduced it through the Xbox app as well.
I think they should. Mm. I think that's
okay,
what it is,
like
isn't
the it? Like the smart glass, you're saying.
Yeah, through the smart glass. I think it's just through the console. I don't know if it's through the smart glass.
Right, but I think with the way everything's going with the new Xbox and Windows 10 crossover, I think everything's going to be.
Yeah, this is definitely, these three are definitely going to be part of some form of app/smart glass integration.
I almost think it has to, with them trying to push to every single device with the same platform.
Yeah, so what's the last one?
Arena. This lets players discover, register, and compete in tournaments, first-party games, as well as third-party game titles from publishers like Wargaming and EA Sports.
So essentially, the developers will create these arenas, so-called tournaments, that you can compete in, but I think Madden and FIFA already do that, right?
Yeah, they announced that on their EA conference that they were going to do these little mini brackets or tournaments. But I think in the Microsoft presser, they said in the coming years, look for the EA stuff to be added as well.
So you think they'll have one for The Flame in the Flood or Quantum Break?
Definitely not. No.
All right.
Crazy. Playdead's Inside comes out June 29th.
Inside Out.
Yeah, and Limbo's now free.
Yeah, download it. I mean, even if you're not even going to play, it's free. Download it. Why not? But this game, if it's anything really like good. Limbo, it's going to be good.
Just graphically, I mean, it was simple with the blacks and whites again, but I thought it looked really good.
They do got some subtle colors in there, too. It's all drab colors, like grays, your whites, your blacks, your, you know, light-colored reds, but yeah, I haven't finished Limbo. I'm almost done. It's a great game,
right.
Sure, this one's gonna be good too.
Sure. Square Enix shows off new Final Fantasy 15 gameplay for Xbox One.
Yeah, I think we already talked about it. Final Fantasy 15 sucks. Tweet me at Pigeon Peg Leg if you think otherwise, but it sucks.
Forza Horizon 3 takes over Australia.
Yeah, I think they did an excellent job on this trailer to like kick the show off.
Yeah, so they got what, like dirt rally cars, they got super cool Lambos, they got what are those off-road truck cars that were like super absorbent shocks.
Yeah, and they showed pretty much, what was it, four different types of gameplay, like
you could do it on your PC, on your Xbox One.
Xbox One, PC, Xbox One S. No, there was two of them on PC, right?
No, I think it was just the two. I think, but there was like four different players, but it was like two on PC and two on Xbox One.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. One was on Xbox One S. One had the steering wheel on PC, and the other one had just a regular controller on PC.
Yeah.
Yeah, and they showed how you could seamlessly join in for like the campaign missions, and the changeover on the servers was seamless. Like it looked really, really cool.
And they're supposed to be crocodiles.
For real? Oh, no. Gears of War. General Ram coming to Killer Instinct.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, I mean, it's going to be cool. I mean, they're definitely keeping this whole thing going with, what is it, Season 3 now?
Yes.
And I did play it. I did play Season 3 a couple. Actually, I forgot to mention that as one of the games I played, I think, 2 weeks back.
Too late.
They redid the lighting
and
the graphics engine in that game. It's pretty cool. Check it out if you get the chance.
90 frames per second.
Speaking of Gears of War, Gears of War 4 will be among the first games of the new system called Xbox Play. Sorry, Xbox Play Anywhere, and releases on October 11th. So this is, it's not only going to be playable on the regular Xbox One S, but it's also going to be playable across play with PC then.
Yeah, Windows 10.
It's
you know,
the first one that's going to be cross-play.
As much flack as Microsoft's been getting, and the indestructible PS4, which never gets any flack, but from us they do, this Xbox Play Anywhere is, if you don't think it's a good idea, you're stupid. I mean, you buy the game on one system, you can play it on your PC, on your Windows 10 PC and your Xbox One. I mean, that's amazing.
I thought it was... I Completely agree. And I was chatting via text with Brett last night on his Twitch, and he was saying that he thinks them doing this is kind of them, you know, kind of putting a an
like
end to the Xbox as a whole, to the console as a whole.
No, not at all.
It's
because
just unifying the user base.
Right. That's what there's always. Too. I said there's always going to be console players, and there's going to be always people who have their PCs and want to upgrade their PCs. I was like, because there's a lot of people that don't want to spend the money on upgrading the PC. They just use it for their internet surfing and doing some word processing.
Dude, you know what I'm thinking? Isn't online play on the PC free?
See, that was where they started talking about that. And I think
they announced
limits on
that
it.
Work.
They announced today, though, that you will not need Xbox Live Gold to do any form of cross-play for Play Anywhere.
But
so
why
would anyone buy an Xbox One console then?
No, what do you mean? Like, why not just
buy it on PC? You don't have to pay for Xbox Live.
Because there's a lot of people that players. There's a lot of people that don't want to build PCs or manage maintaining a PC.
But if you don't have to spend the $60 a year.
Yeah, but that's what they're saying now. You can have your Xbox One and you don't need
gold.
Live gold to play a multiplayer game. That's Play Anywhere cross play.
Oh, so, for Xbox One?
Yeah. So what really, if you look at it, I think what we're getting at now is you're really only paying for Live Gold to get your free games per month and maybe a couple other features. I'd have to look into it, but you're not needing Live Gold to play multiplayer games going forward.
Which I was completely surprised by, because I'm like, I didn't think they'd want to lose that $60 a year from all their Xbox Live Gold members.
Yeah, I mean, I hate to, you know, break off of what we were talking about with Gears of War 4, but it's amazing what they're doing with this Play Anywhere, in my opinion.
They have a really slick trailer. It wasn't shown during the conference, but if you go on the Xbox YouTube site, there's a really cool, I think it's like minute and a half trailer just for the Play Anywhere, and it shows, again, it's very like modern, hipster-ish, you know, most of us don't live this lifestyle, but they were showing how you can just seamlessly start on your console, you know, pause it, save your game, go into work, at the end of your workday, fire up your computer, play. It's pretty cool. They show all the different varieties of the Play Anywhere.
Calc, you don't have to lie. That is Scotchy's life.
Jack Hole. Xbox One S revealed. I know we've kind of already mentioned it a few times.
Well, just real quick before we move on, this Gears of War 4 with this Xbox Play Anywhere,
sure,
you can cross play. You can play anywhere, including co-op campaigns, competitive multiplayer, and the new Horde mode, and it syncs your achievements between the PC and Xbox One, which I thought was amazing. You can play a co-op campaign with someone on the PC and someone on the Xbox One.
Well, they're also touting with that crossplay that, you know, if you're playing something on your Xbox and you pause it, you can go up to your PC and then start it right where your pause thing was.
Yeah, that's mind-boggling.
Well, Pigeon nailed it too. It's player pool. You've just now expanded the potential amount of players for that game.
Yeah,
like 10 times over.
Dude, imagine like us growing up when we thought like the split screen was like amazing, and now you can between a computer and a console. It boggles my mind. Anyway, I'm sorry. That's just crazy.
So the Xbox One S reveal. Microsoft says the Xbox One S will be 40% smaller than the first iteration of the console and will feature an internal hard drive with up to 2 terabytes, an integrated power supply, a new wireless controller with textured grips, and increased wireless range because they're using Bluetooth. The cheapest version of the Xbox One S will retail for $299 and will go on sale in August.
Well, am I the only one, but I think the range of the current controller is fine. I don't play like 50 yards away from my TV.
Yeah, I don't get that. But
Jerry Jones and play on the big giant screen.
Yeah, I do get why they did it though for the Bluetooth, and it makes it work with the PCs without needing the dongle.
Okay, I see. Yep.
The S2, I was explaining to a buddy at work, the S is a perfect price point for people that are getting 4K TVs and looking for the Blu-ray players also.
Yeah. Oh, this is an amazing price point. I'm really surprised at that.
The $299 price point is on a 1 terabit, right?
Or no, 500
gig. Okay, and then the
500.
$349 is the 1 terabit, and then $399 would be a 2 terabit.
Yes, I think that's correct. Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
But still, that's right. It still looks cool. My only gripe is that it's white. I was hoping it was black.
Did you like how they sold that in the advert commercial for that? They're like, oh, and it's got a great white color on it now, so you won't have to worry about the dust collecting on the glossy black. It's like, you idiots knew that the glossy black that you originally designed the Xbox for was going to show off all this dust, but you still
pushed it like, out anyway. Like piano finish. It right. Shows dust so easy.
Yeah. I mean, I like the black console, though. Mm.
Microsoft's... But sorry, go ahead.
I'm sorry. What I was going to say was I forgot what I was going to say. Forget it.
Microsoft, Mike Ybarra.
Mikey Barr, that's right. Good job.
Just confirmed that the Xbox One S will ship with an Ultra HD Blu-ray player. They typically retail for somewhere between $200 and $400. The inclusion of a drive in the new model greatly enhances the $299 to $399 price range. I guess that's...
Yeah.
It greatly enhances the price if you have a 4K TV.
Well, exactly. They were saying, I think, Samsung, their 4K Blu-ray is $400. Right. So they're saying basically the Xbox One S is your cheapest bang for the buck
Ultra 4K Blu-ray.
Ultra Blu-ray player on the market.
Original Phantom Dust getting remastered for Xbox One and PC.
There's your fifth. Fuck.
There's your fifth.
And it comes in 2017.
I got a half a point.
No.
Damn it.
Nintendo news. Zelda, Breath of the Wild. The game
Got a name.
Yeah. The game will be... Oh, yeah. Didn't they have that thing out there that they were getting the fans trying to name it? Or there was a question? Oh, no. That was something that you had ran into in Reddit.
That, right? That was on Reddit. That's when Pigeon got pitchforked and torched
that,
again.
Yeah. That was on Reddit. Someone was like, hey, you know, with E3 coming up, what do you think they're going to name the new Zelda game for the Wii U, you know, /NX. And somebody wrote something funny, and I was like, you know what? That's pretty funny. So I put, you know, what is it? LMFAO? Left my fucking ass off. Yeah. So I just thought, yeah, that's pretty funny.
I appreciated it out there.
Yeah, I just put that out there, and I got negative 14 downvotes. I got 14 downvotes.
You know, it's just because it's you, right?
Well, they check your comment history and go, this guy's a son of a bitch, so they're just going to downvote you.
No. Someone wrote, that's what it is, here. Someone wrote, what do you think the name of the title is? It said, The Legend of Zelda, A Link Between Consoles. Pretty funny, right? Between the Wii U and NX?
Right.
I just wrote LMFAO, and I got, oh, I'm sorry, now it's minus 16.
Nice.
And then the guy who replied to my comment put Legend of Malin, Find an Ocarina. And I guess that means LMFAO.
Right.
And he got 18 upvotes.
Nice. Playing off of your downvotes to get an upvote. That's pretty sick,
yeah.
If you ask
yeah,
me.
Yeah, you jeez. Bastard. I hate that.
All right, so Breath of the Wild. The game will be equal in terms of visuals as well as gameplay on NX and Wii U. I can't see that being equal.
It's weird, but they did do that for the Twilight Princess. The graphics were the same.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's got a very artistic cartoon style to it.
The art style reminds me of the Wind Waker a little bit. I don't know if you watched that trailer yet.
But I'm just wondering, how can it be a little bit better on the NX if the NX is supposed to be great?
Maybe they don't want to delay it again. I don't know.
It says you can play the new Zelda with the Pro Controller as well.
I don't have a Pro Controller. You guys love it. I should have gotten it, but I just figured it's too late for me now.
Hmm. I'd be pissed if they don't. Yeah, because, I mean, the old Wii, you can use all those, the Wiimotes and the Nunchuck on the Wii U, so why the hell wouldn't you be able to use the Pro Controller with the NX?
I don't know. But speaking of this game, have you seen the trailer, both of you guys?
I honestly didn't.
Yes.
It looks awesome, doesn't it?
Yeah, supposedly it's got a very big world.
Yes, and you can approach the enemies, and the one scene is like you get like special ability where you can throw like this huge log, you can shoot the fire to blow them up, or you can go above them and roll like a boulder down in their camp and destroy them.
And I guess everybody's really excited about the shrines. There's like over 100 shrines.
Yeah, to get different powers, I think.
Yeah, yep, something like that.
Oh, nice.
So, I love me some Zelda.
There's also new Zelda amiibos.
And they look amazing.
Yeah, Pidge, you want to give us a rundown on what they are?
The steampunk octopus looks pretty cool.
Yeah, it's they're all coming out in, what, 2017. There's the Link Archer, which I think is most commonly saw from the teaser trailer back from last year, him pulling back the bow with the blue bomb on it. There's the Guardian, which is with the enemy that he was fighting with, kind of looks like an octopus, mm-hmm. but only six legs, which, by the way, I think has movable appendages.
Hey, on the amiibo?
On the amiibo itself. Okay. And then there's also a Link Raider, which is him, which is cloaked and hooded on a horse.
Is that Epona?
Whether it's Epona or not, I don't know, but they really do a good job on making these amiibos.
All in all, 7 new amiibo figures will be added to the Super Mario line in November.
That's all, dude, you see the figures, dude? Waluigi. You got to get Waluigi.
Okay. You don't like Wario with his big gut hanging out in the front there?
I already
have a Wario.
I like Boo. Boo looks Boo cool.
Yeah, I think I would probably pick up Waluigi, Daisy, and Boo, because I already have Diddy Kong and Donkey Kong, Wario, and Rosalina.
Pidge, you have a Kirby yet?
No, I don't. I can't get them, dude. They got it. They don't re-release them either, and I don't want to get the Kirby one from the Kirby series. Mm. I want the Smash one.
Axiom Verge and Severed making their way to Wii U and 3DS.
Hey, real quick, Scott, do you think the Kirby series one, the one that's been released with Kirby Robobot, works with Smash Brothers? Or do you think it's only for that certain game?
It'd probably only be for that certain game since they did release a Kirby Smash Bros.
Damn it. Okay. Thank you.
There might be something. Nah, yeah, it's probably only that one. You might be able to do a save file, but I don't think it's going to let you do a paired option. Yeah, I don't know. Probably not, though.
Okay.
So Axiom Verge and Severed.
Severed is the game after what's that Mexican fighter game that came out on the Xbox One?
Oh yeah, it's
Guacamelee.
Guacamelee. Yes, that's the team who made Severed, and it's supposed to be a really good game. And Axiom Verge is kind of like a Metroid game, which got really good reviews and supposed to be really good, and it's coming to 3DS and the Wii U, which is pretty crazy.
Yeah, I'm kind of surprised. I mean, well, I'm expecting in the Nintendo format of new console releases that anything that's released on Wii U now will be playable on the NX.
Yeah, I'm just hoping that it's cross-buy. Like, if you buy it on the 3DS, you can play it on the Wii U. But knowing Nintendo, they probably won't do that.
Yeah, I can't imagine so. Mario Party. Star Rush for 3DS.
Have you played the Mario Party games?
Yeah, we have the latest one.
Mario Party 10?
Yep. Yeah, that's good. We enjoy it. Jonas likes playing it. He even likes playing by himself because they have an option where you can use the amiibos. I think you have to use the amiibos on the one playthrough to roll. Like, you have to put the amiibo on the gamepad.
Okay, yeah, I think that's right.
It starts the roll, and then once you pull the amiibo off, then it finally throws the dice out.
Right, okay.
So it was cool to do that. It was a little weird because, you know, when you're sitting across the room and you're trying to play a game, it's like you have to, everybody has to kind of be huddled around the gamepad the whole time, but whatever.
Yeah, what I heard, I think it was like Party Island or Island Tour or something for the 3DS for the Mario Party games was pretty good. But for this one that's coming out, you don't have to wait for your turn, which...
That's kind of weird.
Supposedly all players move at once. I don't know how that would work, but it seems like the games would go a lot faster.
I was going to say, that's almost like a free-for-all.
And it's also what everybody wanted in the new Mario Party game.
Right. New versions of Runbo, Deluxe, and Pocket. Deluxe will feature tons of content, and Pocket Deluxe will allow Street Pass.
Yeah, so the Rumbo Deluxe is for Wii U and the Rumbo Pocket Deluxe is for the 3DS.
Yeah, okay.
Sucks, because I already have it. Which, by the way, Scotch, I have a code for it if you want it. Or, Celtic, you guys got to fight.
Ooh, Celtic doesn't have a 3DS.
What is it, the trial by combat? So.
Ooh, I thought that was just next.
The mountain versus the viper, or what?
Yeah.
No, it's zombie mountain versus somebody.
Versus.
Yeah, don't spoil it. Okay. Kelt didn't see it yet.
That's right. Multi-platform news. Activision has announced the Game of Thrones actor Kit Harington will appear in Infinity Ward's Call of Duty Infinite Warfare.
Did you know it was going to sell like gangbusters now?
Of course.
I was going to say, do you think he has pull? Do you think he makes more copies go?
You know nothing, Jon Snow.
You know nothing, Kelk.
I wonder if they're going to have like an Easter egg in there and he'll say something.
They're
going
to have his little redheaded wife.
Oh, she's pretty hot, too. I'm going to look her up right now. But yeah, they're probably going to have like an Easter egg in there. It's like, oh, you know, it's snowing outside there, John.
Yeah, maybe.
Something stupid like that. But yeah, it's kind of smart. You know, everyone's disliking this Call of Duty Infinite Warfare to get this, you know, in the spotlight, absolute, everyone loves the television show to be a bad guy.
Why not jump on the bandwagon?
Yeah, he'll definitely drop the one-liner saying to somebody, you know nothing.
Yeah, it'll definitely be something. It has to be. Mm-hmm. I'll be disappointed if it doesn't.
To aid in bringing Harrington's villainous role to life, director Guy Ritchie was brought in to assist on production during Harrington's filming.
I like Guy Ritchie.
Yeah, it's
all the
pretty
movies
cool.
He's done so far has been good.
That's kind of weird just to bring him in for that filming only.
Hey, when you got that Activision money, it's okay.
Yeah. Games are big bucks now, man.
Games.
Ubisoft confirms Watch Dogs movie is still on the way.
It can be cool if it's adapted correctly.
Yeah,
super cheesy.
I mean, Ubisoft's going all in with these movies between Assassin's Creed, Watch Dogs, and now
Aren't
the Division.
They getting taken over by like Gameloft or Vivendi or something like that?
Vivendi.
Well, they're also working on Ghost Recon, right?
Yeah, with your boy Tom Hardy.
And the publisher's also looking into bringing the Rabbids, too.
I could see Rabbids doing good with the kids, though.
Dude, the cartoon's hilarious. The cartoon's hilarious on Nickelodeon. Like, wah, 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 wah. That's all they say,
dude. Wouldn't it get old after a while? No, maybe not. Okay.
I don't know, but my daughter and her friend had this language when that first came out. They would talk rabbits and they won't understand each other. I'm like, whatever.
Watch Dogs 2 trailer and gameplay was shown.
It was shown before, but.
Yeah, I mean, I think you guys agree. It has a little bit of like a Grand Theft Auto feel to it. It, you know, it's a big open sprawling city. I like the parkour elements to it.
Yeah, I do too.
Well, they maintain that because that was kind of a thing in the last one too, right? Not that there was such the, you know, you keep climbing type thing, but there was like
not even that,
vaulting
but
walls and
like,
stuff.
Yeah, but it wasn't as smooth. I mean, he would hop over a wall here and there, but this one you can like hop out a window, roll, jump over a post and, you know, step on stuff to jump over something else.
Right.
What they're doing is a good step in the right direction.
Hopefully. Like I said, the only thing that I hope that they do fix was the driving mechanics, because I thought that was totally wonky on the first one.
Yeah. Okay.
Ubisoft shows off For Honor's single player campaign. And I guess the whole thing's coming February 14th, 17th.
Yeah. This is my Rise 2 prediction.
You're not getting any points for it.
I know they showed a little bit of For Honor last year, but again, I don't understand all the hate back then. This had the QuickTime events shown. This looks a lot and plays a lot like Rise, but it, you know, it's got the four different factions or whatever you want to call it as far as the players. It looks cool. I mean, I'll definitely check it out. I don't know if I'll buy it. Yeah, I don't know if I'll buy it. I'll try and find a way to
hidden special.
Maybe rent it or do something like that. But it looks cool. But again, this is Rise. So this game should get the type of hate that Rise got, because Rise still is one of my favorite games on the Xbox. I will be, because again, I think Rise and Microsoft itself got a lot of hate out of the gate for the QuickTime events and stuff like that, and I saw a lot of that in the For Honor gameplay.
Mm. I'm looking forward to your hate.
Ubisoft's Steep is a connected action sports game in the Alps.
I think you guys missed most of the trailer for it, but...
No, I watched it with you. Not the whole thing. Seems... I think I saw more like two-thirds of it at least.
It seems pretty cool, and it's really interactive. Like, you can...
Now, there's multiple options, right? Like skiing, snowboarding, and hang gliding.
Yeah, there's skiing, snowboarding, paragliding, and the kind of like wingsuit.
Yeah.
But, was this the one that I was saying was pretty much like Just Cause 3?
Yeah, you made a Just Cause 3 reference, but it's totally not like Just Cause
3. Yeah, I think you were smoking your crack before you made the comment.
I thought it looked really cool.
No, it does look really cool. You were saying like the snow physics look wonky.
They did,
I mean, snow physics look hard to get, I guess.
Yeah, because it's
but,
like as he was sliding sideways, it was just the patterning. I don't know.
Yeah, I got what you were saying, but I mean... After you do your run, you can go back, and if you did like a cool trick at a certain like jump, you can, you know, mark that and put a challenge out to your friends or to the community saying, you know, if you guys can do this, you know, try to match it.
Right, but it gives you the option to just push it to your friends only or out to the public as well, right?
Yeah, I think that's true. And also you can do it you can see your replays from different angles.
Yeah, it gives you free range of the replay camera.
Yeah, it was kind of unique. It kind of reminded me of like SSX on like crack.
Right.
But like real life, not right. Like kind of that wonky afro style snowboarding guy.
Trials of the
Blood
Dragon.
Sorry. Could be interesting. Yeah. Could be interesting.
Trials of the Blood Dragon unveiled. Out now.
Yeah, the trials stuff. Yeah. I mean,
that was the motorcycle shooter.
Yeah, they had like a handgun on them.
Yeah, I mean, it's just an add-on for Trials. Trials, it's a good game, but man, that pisses you off a lot.
Yeah. Grow Home gets sequel. Grow Up.
Yep.
And releases in August.
Paige, my daughter. For the daughter? No, I'll wait for PS Plus, I guess. My daughter loves the game.
Right.
She has a video clip that she likes. She kind of trolls a sheep jumping off a cliff or something like that.
Celtic, keep it in your pants. The Division's upcoming survival expansion detailed. The update hits June 28th for Xbox One and PC. PlayStation 4 owners will get it in August 4th. Wow, that's a month plus.
Yeah.
Additionally, it is. Yep.
Ubisoft is giving away three outfits, Ghost Recon, Rainbow Six, and Splinter Cell. Those will be available soon.
Ooh, Splinter Scotchy. Cell outfit looks cool.
I was going to say, Scotchy, you going to rock the Splinter Cell?
I would if I had it. like, if I can, yeah. Because it's a giveaway, isn't it?
I don't know what it is, but aren't you wearing it now?
Yeah, right this second. In survival, players will have to scrounge for supplies amidst worsening winter weather. Players crash in a helicopter and have to survive by finding food, water, and warmth. Of course, there are also hostile forces.
I like this idea.
That was what I thought kind of we were discussing when we thought, or when we first saw The Division. We thought we were going to have to like scrounge for water and everything else.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. And also another thing too, I think, just real quick, is something to do with the Underground update also has randomly generated missions, if I'm correct.
Randomly generated missions, but that's not the update. That's not this update. It's the following update, I thought.
It's the one called Underground. So I think that's...
Yeah, okay. So it's not this one. It's the next paid DLC.
Okay.
I'm looking forward to that one.
Ghost Recon Wildlands gets a March 2017 release date and new gameplay footage.
This game looked really cool. This is the game that I think... will be able to give us a little bit more of our strategic gameplay. Like, Scotchy, I know you like to play the sniper role.
Mm-hmm.
And some of the screenshots and gameplay showed...
What do I like to play?
The Rambo role.
Your Rambo role, for
and
sure,
what
man.
What do you, Kelk?
Kind of sit back in the middle medic. Type of...
Here's a med pack.
Yeah.
He's like medic support.
Yeah.
heavy machine gun and a whole bunch of health packs.
Oh, speaking of, real quick, back to the Division. The one weapon balance, they said they're going to give the light machine guns a 30% base damage increase.
I have a light machine gun already ready.
So I'm excited for that.
With this Ghost Recon Wildlands, right? It's what? So you could play the game solo or co-op up to 4 players. That's nuts.
Yeah, it looks really good. It looks good.
Yeah.
South Park, The Fractured Butthole, comes out this year on December 6th.
Never played it. I don't think I ever will. It looks funny.
A lot of screen time.
Yeah. Because they dropped like 7 F-bombs.
Yeah, seriously.
Dude, there was a funny scene where he's like, he was telling him a story. He's like, yeah, and then you became a superhero and you went into your parents' room and then you saw your dad fucking your mom. It's like, man. What does that have to do with anything? He's like, it changes your life. You saw your dad fucking your mom. It was pretty funny, but I wouldn't play it.
No? I figured you'd be the first one in line for this in the Loaded Couch.
South Park RPG. Never mind.
Just Dance is coming to the NX in 2017.
Yeah, that was like the first time NX was shown.
What was that intro dance? Is that what that dance was?
Was there something? Costumes, I felt like I ate like 6 pounds of mushrooms before I watched that thing.
Titanfall 2 gets a single-player trailer and release date. 6 new Titans with dedicated abilities and an October 28th release date. That's pretty crazy. Because we haven't heard much about that up until now.
I know Captain's going for the Sword Titan.
I was talking to 40K at work, and he was really excited for this Titanfall 2 game. And I was saying to him, could you imagine if the Titans had the wall run ability as well? And we were both going back and forth saying, if you took the Strider mech with like a recoil booster and the melee sword, you could kind of play like a ninja role with your Titan.
Jumping on fucking walls.
Yeah.
That'd be awesome, dude.
Do the walls crumble under your weight?
No.
Okay.
No.
Not with that Strider mech. He's too light.
Yeah, he's too light. Oh, yeah.
That's true.
He's made of air pocketed titanium.
Nice. Titanfall 2 adds the Six Titans expanded pilot gameplay and deep progression system. New weapons as well, like a gravity grenade, an anti-air laser, and a grappling hook with which pilots can grab other airborne pilots.
Did you see the trailer, Scotch?
No, I didn't.
Dude, at the very end, do you know how like when you eject from your Titan, you fly up in the air?
Yep.
At the very last part of the trailer, the two Titans eject it, you know, on opposite teams, all the way in the air, and one of them threw the grappling hook, hooked him, and when he came in, he, like, punched him to death in midair. That was awesome, dude.
You're like, dude, let's totally record that moment.
Oh, yeah. I'll probably have, like, 15 of well, on me, but, yeah.
As typical with their new mentality of their releases, Respawn won't charge for Titanfall 2's maps and modes DLC.
I'm gonna still have like those rec cards like Halo 5 does. They don't want to split the user base. I think that's what kind of killed them the first time around.
Right.
Calc, you agree?
Yeah, no, definitely. I was gonna say, and you just said it, that they don't want to split the user base this time. So
you sleeping? What's going on?
No, I was on mute. This is great because that's why they had such a big drop off.
Okay. Wake up.
Pigeons Mass Effect Andromeda was shown.
Mass Effect
Andromeda. Yep.
Andromeda was shown.
It did get me erect. I thought it looked really good.
It was a CG though, right? It wasn't gameplay.
No, there was some clips when they were showing the, like the studio scenes and the making, it would cut to the in-game footage.
And I think it's also, instead of your default character is male, it's a default female character. Ooh.
Ooh, is right. Madden 17 was shown with some new features.
Yeah, okay. Ooh. Typical Madden. Yeah, move
on. Another Madden.
FIFA 17 introduces story mode, The Journey, which has you following Alex Hunter.
I wish you could just follow whatever character you created.
Yeah, that's what I thought was.
Instead of Alex Hunter.
EA reveals new esports events, a challenge that's designed premier events and EA major events.
Yeah, this is like those little mini tournament brackets and stuff I think we were talking about with like the arena style stuff Microsoft's doing too.
Right. EA announced a new indie publishing program called EA Originals.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of similar to what Ubisoft has, Ubisoft artwork with the Rayman series.
This one was painful, though.
Fee, the symbol for iron.
Yeah,
the periodic table.
It was like it was trying to be Ori and the Blind Forest and some other.
It came off as really boring because he talked for like 15 minutes.
Oh, no.
Yeah, go on to the next one. I don't even want to give them the time of the day. Give me something better than that presentation.
Guck, anything else on that? You feel the same?
No. I feel the same. We were going back and forth saying, my God, this is painful to watch.
I think we were measuring how long our butt hairs were during that.
A look at EA's Star Wars properties in the works. Next year, you'll be getting another Battlefront.
Yay.
A new action-adventure game that we'll be getting... that we will be getting from Visceral and Army Henning.
Amy?
Army.
Oh, wow. Getting blurry-eyed tired over here. Yeah, Amy Henning in 2018.
A lot of E3 news, dude. Come on, we gotta get through
it. Yeah. A video of Respawn's upcoming Star Wars project.
I think they showed, a 30-second teaser, if that?
Yeah, that was the teaser from Visceral, where the guy walked out of the bar or whatever. I mean, it looked gorgeous.
Yeah, it looked pretty.
Yeah.
Battlefield 1 was shown.
Yeah, you can never get enough of them showing this game. It looks really good from everyone.
What I like about it is the destruction, man.
Yeah, that's always the best part of that.
If they can give me a Rambo game like Call of Duty and destruction like that, I'm in.
I like that it wasn't just trench warfare, too.
Well, you can get that that style of gameplay if you play some of the non-large battlefield and non-vehicle maps. Scott, do you remember what they were in Battlefield when you just did player versus player?
The one was the tunnel, right? And then you came up to the outside. It was
the subway.
Yeah, subway station.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean you can get that Rambo fast-paced action, but just no vehicles and a much smaller battlefield.
Right.
All I know is that I thought I read a bunch of things that people said this is a lot faster than the older battlefields.
That's surprising.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Quake Champions is unveiled. The game would launch as a PC exclusive.
I'm sure it's going to come to consoles. It's inevitable. Right.
The trailer was really cool. Like it gave that instant old Quake arena vibe to it.
I never played Quake, so I don't really care for it.
Skyrim gets a special edition for Xbox One and PS4.
No, it's Spyrim.
Hey, Jackal. The special edition will include mod support. Skyrim special edition is free on PC if you own all DLC or the Legendary edition.
I know you guys were into Elder. I know Scotch was into Oblivion.
Right.
But I don't know if you were
into Skyrim too. I just never finished it. I think
that's right.
Halfway into it.
I think you said your wife got it for you, but you never finished it.
Right. Yeah. The Prey franchise is back.
This looked pretty cool.
I actually have the first Prey. I bought it for $5 on the 360 when it was on sale because everyone said it was awesome. I gotta finish. I was into the first 30 minutes. I have no idea what was going on.
Calc, you're gonna get it?
I might. It's hard to say just from the trailer. I was telling Pigeon it's like the Groundhog's Day trailer because it just kept replaying the same scene
with a dirty eye.
The dirt with the pink eye.
Yeah. Conjunctivitis in his eyeball.
Upcoming Doom DLC detailed. Doom's user generated content and level creator Snap Map is going to receive free updates, including new construction models, props, weapons, and items. Okay.
Yeah, I guess they have these type of arena shooters and the multiplayer. I mean, I know I heard the multiplayer wasn't that great on it, but a lot of people out there really like to build the levels like in Halo. They have, what is it, the Forge? There's a bunch of... Yeah, so there, I mean, people really take their map creating serious. So this is pretty cool to see them add more stuff to that.
Both Fallout 4 and Doom are coming to VR.
Yeah, that's pretty crazy. If they well, I think they said that the Doom was kind of just like a, hey, tour, yeah, tour hell. You know, this is what our environments look like. Look how gorgeous it is.
Right.
And I think Fallout 4 is the one that's getting the complete overhaul
for the VR release.
Yeah, for the VR release. I mean, that could be super interesting.
Well, the Fallout 4 guy, again, I'm sorry, I forget his name, but he was in the Project Scorpio trailer too.
That Bethesda, Carmack? No, it's not Carmack. No. Howard?
It might be, but they're basically
Tim Howard or John Howard or something like that.
They're doing Fallout 4 upgrades for the Project Scorpio also.
Dishonored 2. Is released as well, right? Revealed.
Todd Howard.
Wait, what?
Todd Howard. Yeah. Todd Howard from Bethesda.
Okay. Yes. Yeah, Dishonored 2 was shown in detail. You can play as Corvo or Emily.
Yeah, Corvo was the protagonist from the first game.
I would like Emily to play the first one.
I gotta try it again. The art style is pretty cool, like the exaggerated face and arm length and stuff like that.
Yeah, Scotty, I think Pigeon was saying you might enjoy this because it plays a lot with a lot of stealth elements, like a thief game.
Right. Well, that's the funny thing. Like, I still have Thief to play. I've been meaning to play it on the stream, but I haven't been streaming.
Maybe it's our game for next month for Jack Me Off.
Oh, that'd be good. Clementine is back and looking much older for season 3 of The Walking Dead, along with a new playable character.
Is she legal?
Don't start.
Those games are pretty good. Those Walking Dead games.
Right.
I don't know why people get so excited for this Clementine character. It's just a normal character. I don't know. Maybe because she played scared all the time.
But she's being played by Chloe Grace Moretz.
Is she really? Oh, I like the game a lot now.
Since I don't think anybody changed on their beers, we're all the same. Celtic yay, me yay, and Pigeon nay, right?
Yeah, yes. I'm a nay still.
All right, well, that wraps the E3 segment. We're going to move on to the Brown Breeze after I get a drink. I'm getting thick tongue. So
and sleepy.
Yeah, exactly. All right, we'll be back.
For more from The Loaded Couch, check us out on YouTube, Twitter, and Facebook.
Hey, if you like me, follow me on Twitch and Twitter at Pigeon Piglet.
Yeah!
What's going on, guys? This is Cataclysmic Doom. Make sure to check me out on Twitch and Twitter at Cataclysmic Doom.
Hey, this is Scotch Hound. If you want to hear more from me, you can check me out on Twitter at Scotchhound_LC or on Twitch at Scotch Hound.
All right, we're back with the Brown Breeze section of the show. I think we kind of got refills. I got a weird refill. Celtic didn't get a refill. And Pigeon, what'd you get?
I am drinking the Wheat Wine Ale by Smutty Nose. I think it's Smutty Nose Brewery. Smutty Nose Brewing Company. It's a wheat wine. It's from their Big Beer series. It says 10.7 on the bottle, but on the website it says 11.9. Yeah, I don't know. It's a deep red color. It's a wheat wine, so it's first of its kind.
Okay.
So far, not bad.
Yes.
Wait a second. It's weird. They made it from 2007 up to 2014, and the alcohol content changed over each year. So I don't know what they've been doing, but they're doing a good job with the alcohol content because it's higher now.
Nice. Calc, you're still drinking the, what was it?
The Dogfish Head 120. Okay. Yep.
You got another one?
No, I'm at the tail end of my, told you I was taking it easy tonight, sipping away.
And myself, I'm drinking some H-Reet Birch Beer. It's a local soda company out of Allentown, Pennsylvania. The Owls, hired to star in J.K. Rowling's Harry Potter and the Cursed Child stage play, have all been fired.
You're fired.
Yeah. Live owls have been removed from the production after one owl escaped into the auditorium after it failed to return to the handler during the first show. It's kind of okay. Jesus,
that's too funny. So like,
you're a wizard, Harry.
What did they do? Replace him with like animatronics or?
No, they just fucking killed it.
Yeah, they didn't kill it.
No, there was a. From what I heard, after that incident, when the owl didn't come back to the handler, like the very next day, there was a sign that says "No owls in the current production anymore." Because they don't want the owl to go like scratch someone's face off
sure,
or something.
Of yeah.
With its huge talent.
Oh, man. A new weight loss device offers a novel approach to cutting calories, draining them from the stomach before they are fully digested.
Oh, that seems pretty good idea.
The Aspire Assist system consists of a thin tube implanted in the stomach, connecting to an outside port on the skin of the belly. About 20 minutes after finishing a meal, users connect the port to an external device which drains some of the recently consumed food into the toilet.
That is disgusting.
It seems wrong.
You're like pumping your insides out into the toilet.
Side
effects, I got a better
idea. It's like vomiting. It's just taking the vomit out of your throat.
I got a better
mouth
idea.
And teeth and stuff. Yeah.
Why not just eat cotton balls instead?
Yeah, Jesus. Side effects Holy seen God. With Aspire Assist include nausea, vomiting, constipation, and diarrhea.
Pretty soon we're going to be porting our assholes, our stomach, Jesus. Our throats.
All right, we only have a few questions here from listeners. Sorry.
it sounds like it.
Max Rule, sorry, wow. Max Rule, PC's drools. Wait. Max Rule, PC drools. Okay. What was it like before the interwebs and smartphones? Losers!
This guy's an asshole.
Okay.
I'm
going to downvote that one.
Yeah.
That was the old 5 1/4 and the put your phone on the modem receiver.
Yeah.
No, I'm just talking about like flip phones, like non-smartphones. I kind of enjoyed it. Like
I was going to say, I miss my old clamshell.
I feel like I'm more stressed now that I have a smartphone. I'm always connected. I felt less stressed.
I will say this. You know what sucks about the smartphone era is work. My work says there's no reason not to answer emails and stuff now.
Right.
Yeah, exactly. When I used to work, it was, what was it? It was the BlackBerry.
Yeah.
You always had to get your emails and always answer emails. But before that, I felt so confident in my work. And now it's just like, I don't want to deal with it.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm at home with family. Ugh.
Yeah, just let me clock in and out and
Seriously.
Call it a day.
Yeah, I'm almost, even the cell phone generation is just, I don't know.
Like I said, just the clamp.
I can see this as an emergency device help, but
yeah, the non-smartphones. That was a good you know, I guess you want to call it like a generation or whatever. How long they lasted?
Yeah, that was quick.
Once the smartphone came, fuck you, Steve Jobs. R.I.P.
Yeah. Thanks for the question at Max Rule PC Drools.
Mark Rule.
Mark. Yeah, Mark does. Next question comes from at Ralph Nader for Prez. Any weird fornication stories you want to share?
Kelk.
He made like a tosses. Nice.
Throw it over the fence.
You're like, no, everything's perfect in my world.
Yep, I'll pass on that one.
Oh my gosh, come on. All right, I got a weird one.
Fornication stories.
I got a weird one.
Okay.
So my current wife and I were doing the business, the fornication business, and at the end when I was finishing, I laid out one humongous fart at the same time. And it was terrible. And she could not stop laughing at my face. And I felt so embarrassed. And to this day, she will never let it go. Oh my gosh.
I mean,
it was one of the farts that you like hold in for a long time and then you let go, and it was just like, oh, it felt great.
You totally released.
Yeah, I totally released everything.
Queefing out your ass.
Yeah, it might have been eating out of my front too. Oh, I'm not sure. So does that make you feel any better, Kelk, to tell your story? Or are you still perfect in fornicating?
Still perfect.
What about you, Scotch?
I don't know. It's just the weird noises that can be made in the different body parts, I think. It's kind of like the, you know,
like
when
wood,
you... What's that?
Different locations or anything, or...
Nah. No, I was just thinking, like, it's more just, like, the dumb things, like, where you're kind of laying there and all of a sudden, like, your body, like, the two bodies together kind of make, like, this weird fart noise together. Like the two pieces.
Oh, yeah.
And then it's like you get like the nervous laughs, and it's like okay, you don't want to like get out of the mood, but you can't help but get like the giggles going, and you're like, okay,
yeah, all right, this is weird nothing's... but let's just keep going.
Yeah, okay. Thank you at Ralph Nader for Prez.
What does that have to do with anything? Ralph Nader.
The next question comes from at the good old days. Does your wife ever get mad at you when she asks for help on something, but you can't because you can't instant save or pause the game?
Yes.
Yes, mine too.
That's when you say you can't pause an online game.
Right. But again, how horrible bad is that? What happened to like the old Nintendo? Or not even old Nintendo. But...
You pause wherever you want.
Yeah, exactly.
But even in multiplayer games, I still like, okay, hold on, I'll be right there. And like, I don't care about it, but what if I'm like in a single player campaign or a cutscene, I'm like, just give me like 5 minutes. What the fuck?
And then they go ahead and do it anyway, and then they just yell at you afterwards because you didn't help.
Yeah. I'm like, babe, I couldn't pause it. She's like, who cares? It's more important.
It's just, exactly. What's more important, the game or me?
The game right now.
You're a jackass.
You're like trying to beat Crota, and she's like, come help me.
Yeah, I know. Guys, I'll be right back.
She's like, I'm pregnant. Fight. Don't be an asshole.
No, that's true. Yeah, I gotta do everything I can. I make her feel like I made her feel like shit. You know, literally.
Mm-hmm.
At this point.
All right. Well, thanks for the question. Oh wait, Kelk, you didn't answer.
No. I mean, perfect.
He's perfect. Yeah. Okay. Thank you for the question. At the good old days. our last question comes from at Cheaters Never Prosper. Okay. Have you ever used an exploit or glitch to benefit your game experience?
Just the one in Destiny where we hide behind the crate.
Oh, yeah. In the corner when the really big dude comes out of the big like sliding doors.
Yeah, Volus Tark.
Wait, Volus Tark? Oh.
Yeah, under the stairs, under that ramp.
Yes, yeah. Yes. I'm trying to think of a different one that I've done. I feel like I've done something. I tried to do it in GTA 5. There was a way where the guy in the wheelchair would tell you that he, you know, oh, your next target is to bomb this guy, and you're supposed to put stock in it, and then right before you do it, you're supposed to sell all your stock.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah. There's actually a how-to. You save all, or you finish the game, but you, or everything except for the missions where you have to kill somebody to make investments and you can get like $1 billion.
Yeah, I tried to do it, but it never worked.
Right, okay.
I'm sure I did other things, but exploiting is not right.
Right.
You should be banned forever.
Well, you mean like the game shark or the game genie?
I have it, by the way. It's amazing.
That was like one gigantic exploit.
Yeah, I know. How did they do that? Didn't you have to put in like codes and stuff?
Yeah, I think there was like a little book or something that had all the different codes.
It definitely was. Yeah, yeah.
I have it. So if you want to have infinite lives in like Contra, let me know.
Yeah, I was just going to say the biggest one ever is up, up, down, down, left, right, BA, star, right?
Yeah, the Konami code.
Mm-hmm.
Crazy.
Poor Konami. All they do is make pachinko machines now.
Oh. All right, well, thank you for the question. At Cheaters Never Prosper. Pidge, you're pretty much the only one who's drinking beers right now. Yay or nay?
It's good.
Well,
I like
beers,
it.
I should say not beers, but new beers.
Yeah, yeah, that wheat wine ale. I like it, but I don't know if I would buy it again. So, I would have to say a nay on it.
Okay.
How about your birch beer?
I love it. I was really pissed because this company, A-Treat, actually went out of business for, I think it was like 8 months. It had been a family-owned, kind of really small. The great thing about it is I think almost all of the sodas are caffeine-free. And they had a huge variety. They had, like, grapefruit soda, and, like, it was, like, the cream soda was, like,
grapefruit?
One of my favorites. Yeah. Yeah, the cream soda was one of my favorites because it was, like, a bright red color. It looked like it was horrible bad for you. Probably some horrible food coloring and stuff in it, but it was delicious. That's probably the only cream soda I like. But the birch beer is probably my favorite. They also had like sarsaparilla and a whole bunch of other ones and stuff too.
Oh, that's gotta be disgusting.
I think when they closed, the new company that bought it uses all the old original recipes, but I think they halved like the amount of sodas that they offer.
Mm, okay.
Just to save on costs and stuff. But
yeah, no, you and Kelk are high on the A-Treat, right?
Yeah. Oh yeah. A-Treat's a good one.
And it's cheap too. Always has been.
Fuck your A-Treat. Go RC Cola.
All right. Well, that's the show. I appreciate you guys listening. I was a little bit long-winded, but, you know, that's it. If you guys have any questions, you want to hit us up for anything, Bidge, Kelk, you want to give us the rundown?
Yeah, at the Loaded Couch on Twitter and at the Loaded Couch at gmail.com. Pigeon Pegleg on Twitter and Twitch. Hit me up. I'll fight you with some fighting words about Final Fantasy.
Reddit, Twitch, Twitter.
Yeah. Reddit, Twitch, whatever. I've been getting some positive comments, by the way. Mm-hmm. Maybe we'll add a new segment about Reddit and Pigeon.
All right, and you can follow me at CelticFox_LC on Twitter. And,
how about Twitch? You on Twitch a lot?
Not on Twitch, but again, you can also follow us on The Loaded Couch on Facebook as well.
Yes, The Loaded Couch and Loaded Couch.
Right. And I'm ScotchHound_LC on Twitter and just regular ScotchHound, or I've been actually hitting up the Loaded Couch on Twitch, mostly just chatting and stuff right now. But yeah, check us out, hit us up, and let us know your thoughts.
See you next week. Right,
later, guys.
Later.